Hey, y'all, give it up one time for our worship team. Are they not incredible? Incredible. Matter of fact, I want to shout out everybody who serves in any capacity. If you volunteer, if you lead here at Lakewood Church, throw your hand up real high. I want to take an opportunity. Y'all, let's give them a hand. Just saluting and honoring them for all that they do. They give, they show up. Man, incredible. Well, don't sit down just yet. I want us to do something OG. I want to honor the great legacy of Lakewood Church and something that's been a long-standing tradition here. I want to have everybody lift up your Bible if you have one. Even if it's a glow-in-the-dark Bible that you got to charge, lift up your Bible and repeat after me. We're going to do kind of a remixed, condensed young adult version. Say, this is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Tonight I'll be taught the incorruptible, indestructible seed of the Word of God. I boldly confess my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I will never be the same. Never, never, never. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name. God bless you. You may be seated. Well, I always want to take the opportunity to honor our senior pastors. I will never, ever, ever take this platform without getting the opportunity to honor them. Y'all give it up one time for Pastors Joel and Victoria Osteen, some of the most influential Christian leaders of our generation and maybe of all time. The kingdom of heaven will look different to the tune of billions of souls because of their obedience and honoring their call. And they're the reason we're all here tonight. So, funny story. I'm holding some doors outside of the grand entrance this morning, just kind of helping out as people are coming and going before the 11 o'clock service. And this lady comes up to me and she's like, "You did so good last weekend, you know, when Kanye was here." And I'm kind of like, I don't know what she's saying I did good at, you know what I'm saying? But I'm a little confused, but I help out with all the volunteer teams around here, you know? So I'm just, you know, hey, concerted effort, big team win. Everybody showed up, served. They were awesome. I'm just honored to be a piece of it, you know what I'm saying? And then she was like, no, but your voice was incredible. And so I'm thinking like, I didn't say anything to you, but hello. You know, I'm a little confused, but I don't really quite know where this is going yet. And so then she does this dance move. But it was kind of like in the movie Hitch, where Will Smith stops the gentleman like, whoa, don't. Mm-mm. So she kind of hit this little like, and then when you did this. And I'm like, okay, two things. First of all, do you a favor. Don't continue with the dance move. Your friends might see you, Susan. And secondly, I think you're referring to Torrin Wells. Terry Williams, Torrin Wells, I get it, you know. Just be on the lookout. Mixtape is coming soon. Lakewood light-skinned twins, we in this thing. No, really, don't wait for it, though. That day will never come. Real quick, I want to give a shout-out to my buddy Mel, who's tuning in from Toronto, Ontario, in Canada. Shout-out to my new homie, Usha, in India, tuning in all the way from India. Y'all clap it up. I want to make sure these people feel the love, even through their computer screen. Outside of the country, and I want to welcome everybody in who's tuning in either through Sirius XM radio or watching online. You never have to be in the room to be in the family, but if you're ever in H-Town, come get in this room because there is something sweet in the anointing that sits on this house. Can we take a moment to just reflect on last weekend? How incredible was that? I mean, really, one of the biggest pop culture icons of our time gives his heart to Jesus, gives a phone call to our pastor who journeys with him, disciples with him, builds relationship with him. And then did that just happen seriously at a Sunday night, 7 p.m. Lakewood Young Adult Service? Kim Kardashian in here running around chasing her kids. Kanye, what did you ever think in your wildest dreams? And all you're praying for revival and all you're praying for God to change hearts that could then influence lives, did you ever think in your wildest dreams you'd have your hands held high, tears in your eyes in worship as Kanye West leads? Incredible. Every seat in the building packed, every heart impacted. A call for salvation, thousands and thousands of lives changed through that. And don't get it twisted. It's not about the status or the net worth or the fame of the people in the room. Don't miss me here. It's about kingdom influence. Kingdom and culture just collided in an unprecedented way. It broke records on YouTube and Facebook. People are looking at the church that never would have showed up at church before, and hearts were changed. People came to see the dude who wrote Jesus Walks, and they walked out of here knowing Jesus. And that happened in your service, Lakewood Young Adults. Give yourselves a hand. Representing on a new level. Well, I want to take this thing to the Word of God. We were talking about how we believe that our Bibles have power in our lives. And we kind of talked a little bit about this whole Kanye shindig. So I will be honest with you. I had a title for this message, and then I repurposed it and switched that title out to a title of a Kanye track. And the title of tonight's message is Power. And we're going to explore the paradox of power. And you know what the word paradox means is it almost sounds like it doesn't make sense when you really see it play out. And here's the paradoxical thing I believe that's true about power is this. With power, the more you project, the less you possess. In other words, you try to walk around looking powerful. You're absorbed with having the image of power and exuding that. You actually lack that thing that you claim to carry. And there's a phenomenal story about power, the gift of power, the misuse of power, God's redeeming power in a life that even when you mess this thing up, he still got your back. There's an incredible story. You'll hear me say recommended reading a couple times tonight because I believe we got to go dig in and get these goods, right? I'm not going to bore you and read the entire story straight from the text, but I'll apply it. But recommended reading. If you're writing notes, jot this one down. Judges 13 through 16. In Judges chapters 13 through 16, we meet this hero of the faith, and it's this guy by the name of Samson. And Samson had a really incredible story. So we can start it right here. His land, Israel, had been under domination by the Philistines for 40 years. Somebody say 40 years. That's a long time to be struggling, right? Like you don't like to be struggling for 40 minutes. 40 years. And so God sends this guy, Samson, to liberate his people. But he does it in an uncommon way. He finds some parents that couldn't have any kids. And he talks to the mom and he says, hey, woman, your womb has been barren. You're childless. On your own, in your own power, you could never have kids. But I am here, an angel of the Lord, to report to you that you are actually, in fact, right now, pregnant. And not only are you pregnant, but this baby that you're going to have is called to do great things and free your nation from its oppressors. Let me just sum up the whole Old Testament with this little cyclical thing right here, okay? The whole Old Testament consisted of the following. The Israelites were God's chosen people. They mess up. They sin against God. God allows oppression to happen to them. Doesn't bring oppression on them, but allows them to sit under that for a season. And then when they have somebody stand up in their defense to liberate them by defeating the oppressor, there's a season of repentance and grieving and, oh, I can't believe we betrayed you again, God. We want to get in right standing with you. And so then God would bring freedom and restoration and renew their power as the chosen people. So Samson comes into this story as a judge. We're not talking Judge Judy, the gavel, the gown, none of that. A judge in that time was kind of like a tribal leader, like a military commander. And Samson's role in this thing was to go to battle with strength. The Bible describes him as being super swole. It also says he was a Nazirite man, and the Nazirites never cut their hair. So I'm going to help you just kind of paint this picture. Just you know, use your holy imagination. Journey with me for a second. But this would be like, imagine DeAndre Hopkins from the neck up. And Arnold Schwarzenegger in his prime from the shoulders down. You know what I'm saying? Homeboy was swole. The Bible is clear on that. He had like superhuman strength. And it was for a purpose. God gave him power for a purpose. Now, Samson didn't always live according to his calling and his purpose. You see, Samson had these weaknesses. It's like Superman, kryptonite, right? But with Samson, it was the honeys. And I don't necessarily just mean the ladies. Like, he had his lady issues in there, right? But then there was also, like, a literal honey issue. This is a great example of how he misuses his power. One day he's walking and a lion charges up on him. How many of you know if a lion came up here right now, I'm gone, okay? Samson kills this lion with his bare hands and rips the carcass open and lays it there to rot. He comes back 2 days later after bees had been eating on this carcass. I'm sorry if this is morbid, guys. And the bees have produced honey, and he reaches in there with his bare hands, and he's just eating his honey as he's walking down the street. Like, what kind of savage are you? He had so much power, but then he would also use it in ways that weren't connected to his purpose. Samson was, if you're taking down notes, Samson was always misdirected when he was disconnected. Ooh. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm called, but it's complicated. You know, I believe we all have a little Samson sauce on our life. You know what I'm saying? I'm called, but it's complicated. For some of us tonight, that might mean, man, I'm in the middle of grad school and these exams are hard and I'm trying to do my best and I don't really know if I'm gonna make it and I'm scared to call my mom and tell her that. And then with all this power in this position to be a potential candidate for graduation, I got this weakness. I'm addicted to Netflix and binge watching, and I'm not trying to call anybody out or read anybody's mail. I'm saying by example, and I don't know what that is in your life. We all got that Samson sauce on our life. You called, but it's complicated. Now, here's the crazy thing. We talked about how he defeated a lion with his bare hands, right? You know, he never once defeated a single enemy. Remember, that's what he was called to do, is defeat his enemies, right? He never once defeated a single enemy under his own power. He only ever defeats an enemy when the Bible says these exact words. It says, and then the Spirit of God came on him with great power. What does that tell you? In his own power, he could do the impressive, but only by way of God's power could he do the impossible. Samson ends up killing a whole slew of his enemies, but he does it in a really funky and unlikely way. So first of all, it was the Philistines that were lording over the Israelites at the time, right? Samson gonna come home, tell his mama, hey, I fell in love with a Philistine girl. Now, you know, they're looking at him like, we're pretty sure we heard that you were called to like wipe those people out, but you're like literally falling in love with the enemy. And that moment was ordained by God to set him up to get him in those camps so that he could then do what he was called to do in eradicating and wiping out his enemy. He's tested and tried, and people are begging because the Philistines are trying to figure out, man, how can we make this dude weaker? Like, he is killing everybody out here. He once killed 30 dudes with the jawbone of a donkey. What? What? There's a God moment. That's a whole other. There's something right. Even in there, there's richness. How many times has God showed up for you because he favors you where you didn't have as much as you thought you needed and you got more done with it? Like with your little measly paycheck, as you're crying and praying and believing for this promotion, God just says, you know what? Forget that, boss. Here goes a blessing. He always could do more under the strength that God gave him. People pried at him and pulled at him, the Philistines did, because they wanted to know, man, what is the secret to this power? How can we weaken him for a moment so we can pounce on him? Because he's in here trying to wipe us out. We got to wipe him out. And so he finally lets up and he tells his secret and he's like, well, I'm a Nazirite. We never cut our hair. I've been swole for as long as I had these 7 dreads in my head. And so what you think they did? They cut all his hair off. And so there is a record in the scripture of where his power actually did leave him when his hair left him. Like in his mind, he was convinced. His confidence dwindled. His insecurity increased. He was a shell of himself, timid and shy and unwilling and unable to do what he had been called to do. But then in the moment of his death, he knew he was about to go. His story's over. He's at the end of his ride. He puts his hands against 2 pillars in this meeting place of the Philistines. And he calls out to God, not from a place of power, not in his own strength, not thank you, God, for blessing me with swoleness, but rather, God, I'm weak, and I'm tired, and I'm dying. I got nothing left to give. Would you come and meet me here once again? Would your power come on my life once again? He had had his issues with the honeys. He had had his imperfections. He had fallen short so many times. And even in that place of utter weakness, God met him with power. And the Bible says those magic words. For the third time in his life, this time no hair required, because it wasn't about you to begin with, homie. I don't know what you're dealing with, what you place your security in, what you put your confidence attached to that was ripped out from under you, that left you heartbroken. But even in that place of utter weakness, then the Spirit of God came upon him with great power. And what do you think he did? He pushed against some two pillars he was leaning on, crashed the whole temple down, and everybody had to go. The story of Samson in Judges 16 literally ends with this statement. He killed more of his enemies in the moment of his death than he ever had in his entire life. Ooh. So you mean to tell me he was called before he was conceived? And then didn't quite honor that call at all times because his life was complicated. And then at the end of his ride, he is celebrated as a conqueror, okay? So he's called by God when he's not even yet born. He's used by God when he's dead. God is faithful when you're not faithful. You don't have to be perfect. Homie, for God to do that thing that he dreamed up for your life to live out, you don't even have to be breathing. You cannot stop a move of God. And that story of Samson just makes me think about some things that we see maybe in our culture in this day. And I think that we just do a lot of flexing. You know what I'm saying? Like there's even this phrase going around, weird flex, but okay. You know, when somebody's kind of stunting on the Instagram, but they front like they're not, you know, Javi, you know what I'm talking about. He's laughing over here. Somebody, you know what I'm saying? Like, let me show this Mercedes-Benz logo and this Rolex watch. And in the caption, I'm going to say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. We see through that. Come on, man. Everybody's out here flexing. Here's the crazy thing about a flexed muscle. And my background is in strength and conditioning. So I'm going to give you this nerdy kinesiology answer, but then I promise I'll tie it up. So the funky thing about a flexed muscle is it is actually powerless. It actually produces no power. Any power that's in that muscle has been spent and exhausted and dumped out in the formation of that flex. All the blood that can possibly rush to that muscle with protein to feed it has been spent. All the actin and myosin, these really interesting little molecular things that connect to create a muscular contraction, have already engaged. That muscle has peaked. So when you look at the swole man on the cover of a magazine, that's probably airbrushed anyway. Or you look at any instance in which something is absolutely fully flexed, it's already at its peak. It can't go anywhere but down from there. Imagine if I had my bicep flexed, right, up high, and you put a dumbbell into my hand up here. That dumbbell's got nowhere else to go but down, right? Now, what if my muscles are loose, limber, relaxed, ready? You put a bicep in this hand, you've now introduced purpose to that bicep. And with purpose, it can respond with passion and it can produce power. We get so concerned with able power. What can I do? What am I able to do, right? But the funny thing is, it's really about having available power. Can you be used? Can you surrender, let go, and allow a power greater than you to influence you, live inside of you such that you're connected to it and it is the only thing pouring out of you? Because friends, at that point, honestly, you're more powerful than you ever were on your own anyway. Let's not focus on being able. Let's focus on being available, available for use. My little guy, baby Terry, he doesn't take compliments very well. So if I tell him something really cool about himself, he'll always throw it back on me, right? So I'll be like, Terry, you're awesome. And he'll say, no, you're awesome. And he says it with the biggest smile and a point, and it's just like, it touches dad's heart, right? But I want him to understand that he actually is awesome. Like, thank you for the compliment, but you're awesome too. No, you're awesome. And we go back and forth. So I try to talk him into, well, maybe we're both awesome. And then he's like, you're both awesome. Like, that didn't work, right? And so then I'm like, hold on, man. So like, you got to get this, okay? So if you think that I'm awesome, let me just remind you that you are my offspring, right? I am Terry Jr. I'm the son of Terry Sr. I'm a reflection of Terry Sr. You, Terry the Third, are a reflection of Terry Jr. If you see something awesome on me, let me just remind you, it's woven into the fabric of your DNA. There's nothing you can do about it. You are awesome. And we are created in the image of God, the Bible says. When you sing praises to the Father and you humbly say, God, you are awesome. Let me just tell you, as a dad, your dad loves you. And he's looking back at you like, yeah, I know, Sheila, and you're awesome too. Receive that tonight. There's a power so much greater than you could ever produce that is readily available to you if you will say, I am available for use by it. And that's the power of God on your life. Well, one time we went to the doctor and baby Terry had to get blood drawn. I can see mama, she's half laughing, half crying. It hurts to think about baby boy getting blood drawn. But then the story is just so hilarious. So there's some negative Nancy's sitting in the lobby of this place where we're going to get blood drawn. And, you know, they're like, oh, that little guy, he's so precocious and he's just running around. He's so excited. Yeah, that mood's going to disappear as soon as they prick him with that needle. Ha, 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 ha. And I'm like, man, I'm ready to knock some teeth out in here. You're talking about my child. So little man goes to the back, and he had been just on cloud nine the whole day. Yeah, I'm going to the doctor. He's hype. He's lit, okay? He gets back there. Sure enough, they stick him with the needle. He's back there with mom. I'm hanging out with baby bro in the lobby. I can hear him scream from the lobby, okay? He sounds like he wasn't getting a shot. He sounds like he's getting stabbed, okay? So then the people next to me, and God help me, I was trying to be quiet and keep my cool and be Christian. But the people were like, yeah, there he goes. Hear him back there. And they're having their conversation to their own. They weren't going to talk to me. He's like, don't look me in the eye, bro, because it can be on in here. Okay? So he's screaming, wailing, crying. And then after a moment, his episode of getting his blood drawn ends, and he comes back out toward the lobby, and one of the ladies at the desk says his magic word. She says, buddy, you did awesome, right? And so an interesting thing happened this time, though. He didn't deflect it and say no. His favorite word these days is because. And so he said, because my daddy's awesome. Now, how do you think that felt to hit dad right in the feels? You know what I'm saying? Big dog, we were talking about limiting sugar, but come on with it. We gonna hit the candy store right now. Anything else you'd like? Pancakes? Done. Right? Borrowed a credit card? Well, we're not there yet, but we... My point is, you are awesome, but you are at your most awesome when your awesomeness is connected to the heart of the Father. You are always going to be misdirected when you are disconnected. But when you connect to the ultimate power source, you are unstoppable because you possess a power inside of you that's greater than anything that could have ever come out of you. I got three key points I want to share tonight on this idea of power, and they all are centralized around this point right here. If you're taking notes, jot this one down. The path to power is vulnerability. The path to true everlasting power is saying, I don't got it. I'm not enough. It's like that worship song, Here Again, that we just sang. It says, I'm not enough unless you come. Would you meet me here again? Wow. If only we could really actually take in that revelation and live from that place. Because the crazy thing about our God is every single time we pray that prayer, he does come and meet us again. Vulnerability is the power to welcome some input that's going to change your output. Got three quick things I want to share on that. And they are retreat, relate, and recharge. Retreat. It's so funny how we do so much of this trying to shine in public. Frankly, I feel like we need to do a whole lot more in private, right? I was watching my Astros. So sad they didn't win a World Series, but I was watching my Astros. I heard a over here. We still got open wounds. I know. Too soon. So I was watching my Strohs, and I remember seeing a pitching change, and they brought in this cat that, in my mind and the minds of many fans, is the greatest pitcher in the world. And I'm like, oh, shut down city. We're about to win this game. And then the commentator said something that really messed with me. He was like, well, he's in there off a short rest. We don't know if he'll have the same power on his throws tonight. And I'm like, no, that's crazy. You're talking about the best in the game. This is the LeBron of pitching. You know what I'm saying? Like, we got this. We're going to win this by a blowout. Easy. It's done. And then he was affected by that lack of rest. And then he's getting frustrated. And then the errors are mounting up. And then the other team's score is mounting up while ours stalls and stays the same. It's better to have a less potent pitcher on more rest because he can produce more power. You know those times when you just didn't quite get enough sleep and you wake up groggy? And then through the whole day, you just feel like your battery is low and you just don't have the same oomph to you. You don't have the same great ideas, clarity of mind. Rest is an important thing. And that's an important piece of that retreating thing. If you want to be shining in public, you better be snoring in private. We don't like that, right? Hashtag all grind everything. Hashtag hustle now, sleep when I'm dead, right? The no sleep movement is so toxic. A storm happens at sea. The disciples are freaking out in the boat like, oh my goodness, what do we do? How do we stop this thing? You know what Jesus was doing? He was literally asleep in the middle of a storm. And then when they woke him up, he's like, oh ye of little faith. And that's the New King James Version of, why are you tripping? And he speaks to the storm calmly and the storm goes away. The man who produced the most power in that situation was the one who was in the most powerless position to begin with. The next one is relate. You'll notice this gorgeous picture of these fall aspens here, and it's not just by coincidence. It's not just because we're here at Thanksgiving week and it's awesome to see the beautiful oranges and yellows. By the way, has anybody noticed, like, Houston got a fall this year? Like, it's so colorful. It's so beautiful. Well, recently I was out on a trip, and I was out in Utah, and it was incredible. I was out there with this group that does some work within the athletics world, and we were hiking in mountains, and everywhere we looked, we saw these gorgeous aspen trees. We saw moose. I was a little scared. I was shook. I ain't gonna lie. I was just praying in tongues under my breath. We got through it. But one of the guys out there is just this mountain man extraordinaire, and he asked me this really cool question while we were out among these gorgeous aspen trees. And he said, do you know what the world's largest organism is? And I'm like, I don't know. I guess the moose? We just saw one of those. That thing was huge. It's like the size of an SUV. You know what I'm saying? And he was like, no, it's actually the aspen tree. And I'm laughing. I'm not gonna lie. I'm like, I thought you were an expert, bro. Like, there's no way, right? Like, an aspen has a really thin trunk, okay, and it goes really high into the sky. An aspen doesn't look in any way as large as, say, a cedar or an oak or one of those trees that you read about when you were a kid. You got those weekly readers. I don't know. I mean, this is a lot of millennials. I'm an old man. We used to have this thing called the weekly reader, and we read about, there was a species of tree that it takes 2 entire minutes just to walk around the trunk. And I'm looking at these aspens like, I could sidekick that joint and it's gonna snap. But then he went on to explain, yeah, you're just looking at one piece of a large organism. And he went on to explain that every single aspen in a forest is connected. So the aspen itself is not just that one tree. One tree can draw on the strength of any other of the thousands of trees in that forest. There's an underground connection of the roots. Somebody take your hands and just cross them like this, to where your fingertips are touching the backside of the opposite hand. This is what the root system of the aspens is like. So you don't have to be that tree to feel the literal imprint of the DNA of another tree. So if one tree's immune system is down and it's dying and it's sickly, another tree 3 miles away can send word through the root system and rejuvenate that tree. The Apostle Paul talks about this in the New Testament, and he talks about how we are the body of Christ. Many members, one body. And as we explore vulnerability as an access way to power, I want to just pose this question.
Who are you connected to in that way? You lack some strength? It don't matter if David is lacking strength, because David is part of a forest. There's about 1,100 in this room right now. He's 1,100 strong by way of our collective power. He's a piece of a bigger body. What's also incredible about the aspen tree is even a forest fire doesn't wipe out aspen trees. This gets really crazy. So for one, because of its complex underground root system, those stumps can burn down and they rejuvenate underground and they just grow right back up. Then the forest fires would kill all the other trees around them, now giving them access to hog all the sunlight, and they grow even taller. The thing that was meant to harm them works out for their good. The weapon that was formed against them doesn't prosper. All things come together for their good. That's the power of community. Maybe you're in a life group. Maybe you're already connected to others in a great way. But I want to just challenge you with this, and you don't have to do it right now, but think on it tonight. Who's that person that you can text and just get vulnerable, raw, and honest within a safe space of a trusted conversation in right relationship with somebody who you know the character of, and you can just say, This is that Samson sauce. I know I'm powerful. I know I'm called. I know I'm chosen. I know I'm ordained. I know that I'm blessed. I know that I got great things coming for me. But this is that weakness. Allow somebody else to work in some strength in your area of weakness. I was recently in the gym with one of the homies, and this cat has so much wisdom. 10 years younger than me, but I feel like 10 years wiser than me for what he draws out of lived experiences and the word of God and how he applies it and the things that he understands in ways that I'm like, wow, I marvel at it. And he was referencing Brené Brown and how she views vulnerability, and she explains vulnerability as courage. Like, one of the most powerful things you can actually do is vulnerability. Courage, in fact, isn't just something it takes to be vulnerable. Courage literally has the same definition as vulnerability. The root word of the word vulnerability is core in its Latin original form. And the definition of core is to tell the true story of who you are with your whole heart. Ooh. You know what's funny is our core is our most vulnerable area, right? You get an invite to the pool party, you're like, dang it, I didn't have that summer body right just yet. Your core is that one piece. Like, if I can just keep a shirt on, I'm all right. I don't know if I'm trying to let everybody in to see my core. And it's the same way with your vulnerability. We're not giving everybody access, right? But we're finding that sacred and safe space where we're able to tell the true story of who we are with all our heart, leaving nothing unspoken. And then the last piece is recharge. I believe that we need a greater connectedness to our ultimate power source, to God. Now remember, Samson could do the impressive all by himself, but he needed God on his side to do the impossible, to do those crazy exploits that only a superhero could ever do for the glory of God in defeating his enemies. And the same is true for us. And I think a lot of times we don't really lean on the power source. We lean on the gifts, right? Say you're good at singing. I'm going to lean on this gift of singing, and it's going to take me to the Grammys. You're good at hooping. I'm going to lean on this gift, and I'm going to make it all the way to the league. And what if you tear an ACL and you don't make it, right? The gift is beautiful, but the gift is dead without the power source, friend. And I think about our iPhones, and they have so many gifts for us, right? Like, we call it a phone, but whoever really talks on the phone? Do y'all talk on the phone, or do you be like, let me decline this, text me, bro, right? Social media and Waze and the notes you're taking right now from this message in the phone. The phone is used for everything but a phone. It's got so many gifts and so many incredible things to bring us. It's a powerful tool. Some people use it to make power moves, we would say, and it's got a powerful impact on culture. It has changed the way we do business and conversation, right? All right, bet. So let that joint not charge for 24 hours. And how powerful is it now? God is our power source. God is the plug. Think about it like this. The iPhone we treat like a gift, and the charger we just treat like an accessory, right? You're not going to forget your iPhone when you leave home. You got to have that with you because it's like your life is on that thing. I saw a commercial for a security company recently, and it said, we store more private information on our cell phones than in our whole home. I was like, Jesus, that's real. You wouldn't leave your iPhone at home, but you might leave your charger at home. You ever had that friend that's like, hey, what percent you on? I need to get a charge. First of all, this is my charger, homie. Ask me what percentage. I'm on apparently more than you. It's going to stay that way. Look at your position when connected to your power source, connected to God as your power stance. Do we treat God as an accessory or a necessity? Because if God's just an accessory, yeah, I just plug in on Sunday night. Cool. Got my little 2 cents for the week. I'm good. But if we treat God like a necessity every single morning, God, I can't do it without you. I'm not enough unless you come. Would you meet me here again? And the beautiful thing is his answer is always going to be yes. He'll always come back to meet you there again. He'll always give you the power that you couldn't access on your own. He'll always elevate you, friend. Your connectedness to your power source is your power stance. Think about when you're bound to a wall by a cord. You ever had a really low battery, like in an airport or a mall, and you're plugging in a really unlikely place? If people are walking past you, you are in the way, but you're like, man, I'm here. I'm committed because I need to get this power. You don't understand. I'm not going anywhere else and unplugging until I'm fully charged. I need this power, right? I want to just encourage anybody who struggles with that, who feels like maybe that's a limiting thing. Like, you know, homies, I can't go where you going because I'm over here connected to this. Understand, you're not limited by that. You are limitless because of that. And I want to give us an opportunity tonight to just get charged up, to get reconnected to that power source. We'll go ahead and have everybody stand. We can close your notes. We can put away your Bibles. And I want to just lead us in a prayer because I believe prayer is powerful. And I just want to ask this question. Is there some area in your life where even though you know there's power on your life, you know you're called, you also know it's complicated? You've got that area of weakness that just nags at you. You might have carried guilt because of it, shame because of it, fear because of it. You might have felt like you're not good enough because of it. You might have felt like there's some dreams that you just got to let go because, man, I give up. I'm done. What's the use in even continuing to pursue this? It's too hard. I'm not enough. Think of that area of nagging weakness. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer here in a moment. And I want you to just submit that thing to God. I say this respectfully, but you're right. You're not enough. And you can rejoice in that because your strength can't sustain you anyway. If it was your strength that got you in the building, your strength won't keep you there. But there's a power greater than you that we can accept into us such that we move forward doing the impossible. You can walk on water. You can move mountains. You can do anything by faith. In right relationship, in connection to the power source, you can do so many things that you could never do under your own strength. And if you have that area of nagging weakness that you would just say boldly, yeah, that's me. I want this new power. I want you to go ahead and throw your hand up real high, wherever you might be. Hands up all over the room. Let this encourage you that this is an everybody thing. It's not just you and yours, me and mine. This is an us thing. We all got that Samson sauce on our life. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your power. We thank you that we can take the time to just tap out and retreat. And we can step away from the space that would elevate us socially or even financially. We can step away from the bright lights. We can step away from the likes, the follows, the getting caught up in culture. We can step away and just simply find rest in the quiet place with you.
And that with right relationship with those around us and with you, our power source, we can open ourselves up in a courageous way to true vulnerability in order to access true power, a greater power than we could ever have produced on our own. As you come on our life with your spirit, with great power. In Jesus' mighty name, we receive that we're not enough, but because you're here, we are enough. We are enough because of you. We are enough because by your stripes we are healed. We are enough because your word is yes and amen. We are enough because you called us and chose us before we were formed in our mother's womb, and you know the plans you have for us, and that those plans are for hope and a future, and that with long life you will satisfy us. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Want to ask one more question, and this is my absolute favorite thing that we do here at Lakewood Young Adults, because this is where my journey with Jesus started. I want to ask if there's anybody in the house tonight that said, man, that sounds really good, being connected to that power source, but like, where do I begin? How do I even? Entering into a relationship with Jesus Christ is the way by which we access that power. You know, we talked about Kanye a little earlier. I love how he shared in one of his Sunday services. He said, let's be specific. It's not a vibe. It's not energy. It's not the universe. It's the creator of the universe. And by relationship with his son, Jesus, you have access to eternal life. My parents are awesome. And they brought me up in the church. They did everything they could. And then there came a moment of realness where it's like, ooh, I can't just be carried under their wings. They've done awesome. But it's time for me to make my faith my own. And I got to make my own decision. And Jesus was knocking on the door of my heart, and I said, I'm going to let you in. If you want that relationship with Jesus, I'm going to give you an opportunity, and I'll pray with you. Let's go ahead and close our eyes, bow our heads, and in this atmosphere of faith, in this moment, if that's you and you say, Jesus is knocking on the door of my heart right now, I can't deny it. I'll count from three, give you an opportunity to respond just by lifting up your hand again. Three, you want to give Jesus your heart, give him your life. We're not talking about religion. We're not talking about just check in and play a Sunday morning game. We're talking about doing this thing long haul with him for life. Two, we're talking about tapping out, giving up. I don't want to do this thing on my own power anyway. I want to invite your power in. One, if that's you, go ahead and throw your hand up real high. Awesome. Praise God. Hands up in every section. You can go ahead and put your hands down. You can look up at me. I want to encourage you to do one more bold thing. I was where you are 15 years ago, starting an incredible new journey with Jesus. And I can tell you right now, as fresh as I could have in that moment, it's absolutely the greatest decision I've ever made. Jesus says, if you won't be ashamed of me before man on earth, I won't be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. So I want to give you a great opportunity to just show Jesus you're unashamed. If that was you, you stuck your hand up, or even if it wasn't, but you want to give your heart to Jesus or rededicate your life to Jesus, come on down. Come on down. Let's applaud them as they make their way down. Maybe a friend will come with you. Maybe a leader will come with you. I just want to lead us in a prayer right up here at the platform. And let's make this thing official. Let's get you connected to this power source. Y'all give them a hand as they come. Hey, maybe you didn't even put your hand up, but even in this moment, even in this moment, you're making that decision. Come on down. It'd be my honor to pray with you. Proud of you. Let's pray. Everybody, heads bowed, eyes closed, just one more time. And for everybody who responded, I want you to just pray this prayer fervently from a deep place in your heart, the most sincere place that you can. And everybody else in the room, let's pray this prayer together as if it were our first time. Say, Jesus, it's me. I stand before you tonight, and I ask you to forgive me of all my sins, all my mistakes. I receive you into my heart as my Lord
and my Savior. I want to live my life for you and you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can we celebrate these new beginnings, family? Friends, I want to just encourage you, your life will never, ever, ever be the same for the better. When Jesus comes in, you're a whole new creation. It's not that life automatically gets easier, but your life now has a new power. The power that raised Jesus from the dead now lives inside of you. You are unstoppable. I want you to look over here to your right, my left. You'll see Trish over there. Wave real big, Trish. What we're going to do is we're going to follow Trish out. We just want to give you some quick resources. If you don't own a Bible, we're going to hook you up with one. We're going to pray over you. We're going to give you some just key fundamental practicals that will help you in your newfound journey with Christ. I'm going to jump out there in a moment as well. I want to connect with you too. We love you. Let's go ahead and follow Trish. She's going to lead you out to our new room. You can just head out that way. Y'all give it up one more time for these new beginnings. Friends, just remember, on your own, you're not enough, and that's okay because you don't have to be enough. When you tap out, you surrender and just say yes to your will. God's power comes upon your life in a mighty way that even you can't deny. His will for your life is so powerful, it would scare you if you could see it. And I hope that you're encouraged by that tonight, and we hope to see you next week. We got Leland coming next week to lead us in an incredible night of worship. It's going to be awesome. I want to speak this blessing over you as you go. Number 6, may the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord show you his favor. May he have mercy on you. May the Lord watch over you and give you his peace. We love you. See you next weekend. You are dismissed.